Hello and welcome to Inside Ophthalmology. We are doing the corneal dystrophy series. Today we are going to discuss the macular corneal dystrophy, also known as the Gronau type 2. And this is also referred to as the first spotted dystrophy. Now this is one of the non-TGF corneal dystrophies. In our previous lecture, we discussed the TGF related corneal dystrophies. So this one is a non-TGF corneal dystrophy and it is the most severe among the three classic stromal dystrophies. That means I'm talking about among the lattice corneal dystrophy, granular corneal dystrophy and the macular corneal dystrophy. The macular corneal dystrophy is the most severe. This macular corneal dystrophy falls under the category 1 of the corneal dystrophy classification, meaning that the gene has been mapped and identified. The mutation here is not in the transforming growth factor beta gene. Instead, it is in the CHST6 gene, which encodes for carbohydrate sulfotransferase. The inheritance over here is important and also it is commonly asked in examinations. Most of the corneal dystrophies are autosomal dominant, whereas the macular corneal dystrophy is inherited as an autosomal recessive trait and it is often seen in the consanguineous families. The gene, I told you, is located on chromosome number 16 and the mutations involve the CHST6 gene. A unique feature of macular dystrophy is its classification into three immunotypes based on the keratin sulfate antigenicity. Keratin sulfate is a sulfated glycosaminoglycan which is normally present in the cornea and its presence can be detected using the antibodies. In type 1, the keratin sulfate is completely absent in both serum as well as the corneal tissue. In type 1A, the serum lacks detectable keratin sulfate, but the keratocytes in the cornea, they still react with the antibodies. And in type 2, the keratin sulfate is present in normal amounts in both the serum as well as in the cornea. The underlying defect in the macular dystrophy is abnormal synthesis of the fibrillogranular material, which is consisting of the glycosaminoglycans, glycoproteins, and lipids instead of the normal keratin sulfate proteoglycan. Now, this is linked to the CHST6 gene mutation affecting the sulfotransferase activity. However, unlike the systemic mucopolysaccharidosis, which involve a defective breakdown and systemic accumulation of the mucopolysaccharides, the macular dystrophy represents a localized synthesis abnormality. Now let's talk about the histopathology. The histopathology of macular corneal dystrophy shows abnormal accumulation of the glycosaminoglycans, and these can be deposited between the stromal lamellae, beneath the epithelium, and also inside both the keratocytes as well as endothelial cells. So what I mean to say is that the abnormal mucopolysaccharides or glycosaminoglycans, they accumulate both intracellularly as well as extracellularly. Under the light microscope, we can see degeneration of the basal epithelial cells with even focal thinning of the Bowman's membrane. And on the electron microscopy, the keratocytes will look swollen and they are filled with vacuoles which contain the mucopolysaccharide material. The Descemet's membrane also shows changes, particularly in its non-banded posterior portion where the granular material, vesicular material might be deposited. Okay, so together these histological features are going to reflect the defective synthesis of keratin sulfate and they explain the progressive stromal clouding which is seen clinically in these patients. This histological picture shows the deposits of abnormal glycosaminoglycans that appear blue with colloidal iron stain. Other special stains that may be used for macular dystrophy are the Alschen blue, colloidal iron, PAR stains and the metachromatic dyes. On slit-lamp examination, the earliest finding that you see in macular dystrophy is a faint ground glass-like haze in the central cornea. This is best appreciated with the oblique illumination. Also, as the disease progresses, you might see multiple small grayish-white opacities. These opacities do not have discrete borders as we saw in case of granular dystrophy. They might have irregular borders and shapes, and the key point over here is their distribution. In the central cornea, the opacities will be more superficial and prominent as can be seen in the image, whereas in the peripheral cornea, they are deeper and they are more discrete. In the advanced stages, however, the entire stroma will become diffusely hazy and the Descemet's membrane also might get affected. In these cases, the Descemet membrane will take on a grayish appearance and the corneal surface will become irregular. These progressive changes explain why the vision deteriorates steadily and why patients often complain of increasing glare and photophobia over time in case of the macular dystrophy. And so although it's a rare dystrophy, when it occurs, it is the most severe dystrophy out of the three common classic dystrophies that we discussed, lattice granular and macular dystrophies. The clinical course of macular corneal dystrophy usually begins early, between the 3 and 9 years of age, with symmetrical changes in both the eyes. The first sign, as I told you, is a faint ground glass haze in the central stroma. As the condition progresses, the haze spreads towards the periphery and eventually involves the entire corneal thickness by second decade of life. Also, important point to remember is that the macular corneal dystrophy can extend up to the limbus without any clear zone. Multiple irregular gray-white nodules appear, and because they protrude slightly, they will cause surface irregularity. And in the peripheral cornea, we may also see deep posterior plaques, diffuse grayness, and the involvement of the Descemet's membrane can sometimes lead to appearance of guttate. These progressive changes explain again the gradual loss of vision and sometimes even severe impairment in macular dystrophy by 20s or 30s. Let us try to differentiate the three important classic dystrophies based on their morphological features. In lattice corneal dystrophy, the earliest lesions are fine refractile lines and dots that will form branching stromal pattern, and this will give the cornea a distinctive lattice-like appearance. The central stroma also will develop diffuse haze, which can affect vision over time, but importantly, the limbal zone usually remains clear except in severe and advanced cases. So recognizing this pattern will help you differentiate it from the granular and macular dystrophy. In granular corneal dystrophy, the stromal opacities are discrete and they have sharp borders, which will make them easily distinguishable on a slit-lamp examination. And early in the disease, the stroma between those opacities is clear, although it may become hazy as the condition progresses. Subepithelial spots are often present, adding to the surface irregularity. Unlike the macular dystrophy, here in granular dystrophy, the lesions usually do not extend up to the limbus, remaining confined to the central cornea. So this will help you differentiate the granular dystrophy from the macular dystrophy. In macular corneal dystrophy, the stromal opacities are grayish white. They have indistinct margins and the intervening stroma also appears hazy even in the early stages, and the lesions often extend towards the limbus. So unlike other stromal dystrophies, the Descemet's membrane and the endothelium can also be affected in macular dystrophy. In terms of depth, the central lesions are located more anteriorly in the stroma and superficially, whereas the peripheral lesions are deeper. This will help you differentiate the macular dystrophy from other stromal dystrophy on the slit-lamp examination. Also, the macular dystrophy is autosomal recessive. The other two dystrophies are autosomal dominant in inheritance. And the other two are TGF-beta-1 related, whereas this one is non-TGF-beta-1 related. So let's discuss the management. It depends on the severity. For photophobia, tinted lenses can help. Recurrent erosions are treated with lubricants and therapeutic lenses. Phototherapeutic keratectomy may be used in early cases when we talk about surgical treatments, and lamellar keratoplasty is occasionally done, but penetrating keratoplasty is the standard surgical option because we know that this macular corneal dystrophy can actually involve the deeper layers of the cornea as well. Recurrences do occur in the grafts, and interestingly, the larger grafts tend to have lower recurrence rates.